This is All India Radio. In the program Spotlight, now we bring you a discussion on the 12th BRICS Summit, Global Stability, Shared Security and Innovative Growth. The participants are Sandeep Dixit, Strategic Analyst, and Simran Sodhi, Journalist.
Prime Minister Narendra Modi today addressed a virtual summit of the BRICS nation, and primarily the focus was on economic recovery amid the COVID-19 pandemic. The BRICS summit comprises of Brazil, Russia, India, China and South Africa and has been a key regional member in the various factors going around. Mr. Dixit, when you look at the Prime Minister's address today, NPM touched on many of the issues which include the economic recovery on the COVID-19 pandemic. He also said that the intra-BRICS cooperation can be increased. How do you feel that this intra-BRICS cooperation, which is being talked about and emphasized, can be further increased?
Actually, members of BRICS interact at various levels, at the official level, ministerial level, at the civil society level, academic, students, youth. So they have about 150 meetings in between each annual conference. And there they touch on a lot of subjects. So today the Prime Minister basically told the main subjects that are being taken up at BRICS. And he spoke, for instance, and he welcomed the finalization of the counter-terrorism strategy and also asked for backing of BRICS members for a unique India-South Africa proposal for relaxing intellectual property laws so that low-cost research in COVID vaccine, in COVID treatment and in COVID drug supply can be done. And then there is another area where the Prime Minister sought the cooperation of BRICS members, and that was cooperation in economic. He said that the world is poised for a post-COVID era recovery, and India, with its policy of Atmanirbhar Bharat, which is resilience and self-strengthening, he said it could be a new engine of growth for the world economy. While India would help itself, it will also help the other members of the world, including BRICS countries. And in this respect, you will recall that India had sent pharmaceuticals to 150 countries, and half of the supply on the basis of a goodwill gesture or on the basis of grants. So India has been working with BRICS countries to ensure in the COVID pandemic, vaccines are distributed at affordable cost, treatments come at affordable cost. So that one feels is a very important contribution in the present day crisis of COVID.
We saw that the Prime Minister also touched on the topic of terrorism, and the PM clearly said that the terrorism is the biggest problem the world is facing today. He went on to say that we have to ensure that the countries that support the terrorists are held accountable, and this problem is tackled in an organized manner. How important is it that we are raising this at a forum like BRICS, where we also have China as one of the members, and we all are aware of the warm relationship which China shares with Pakistan?
As far as about the BRICS counter-terrorism strategy, again, this has been done with a certain degree of consensus. And the real heart of the aspect of this counter-terrorism strategy is to push for early adoption of CCIT, which, as you know, is an India-sponsored resolution in the United Nations. It talks of Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism, where, as you have just now very rightly mentioned, any country that is using terrorism as a matter of state policy. So it is a process of consensus, and it will be better in the interest of all countries, as you know, that they adopt zero tolerance towards terrorism, because it then comes to bite back, as one of our neighboring countries has been experiencing for some time.
Do you feel that BRICS then serves as a forum where the convincing of China can take place, that maybe the support to terrorists and terrorist states has to go down?
It requires patience. For instance, China would be realizing that India has a financial strength of its own that cannot be matched by its other so-called iron brother. And this China has seen in New Development Bank, where we had a banker, K.V. Kamath, from India, who led the New Development Bank, which is the BRICS Bank. And the BRICS Bank has already lent India $1 billion to fight COVID. In fact, if you recall, it was one of the earliest lending tranches that came from any multilateral institution. It came in April, if I'm correct. Now, NDB has put up $10 billion to do that. Similarly, the NDB has now arranged for a contingency reserve arrangement of $100 billion, so that if any of the currencies, then there is another port of safety where these countries can go to, besides, as you know, the IMF. So there's an alternative that has been given to all these countries. And then, moreover, as you know, India is a global player. And it has multifaceted and very diversified national interests. So security is one interest. Terrorism is one interest. And besides these interests, there are other interests. So India's effort is to make sure that we align as much as possible in most of the other interests with other countries, whether it is China or Russia or the US or UK, Japan, whatever, and try and get the best out of it. So we have been doing very well in the financial area, for instance, with China. And as I just mentioned, that in the India-South Africa initiative for relaxing of IPR laws, China supports India, whereas Brazil does not support India. So maybe the BRICS can be a very good forum for ironing out differences with Brazil in this respect. And who knows, in the near future or long-term future, we might also be able to convince China to walk the good and the narrow path that the rest of the world community takes.
We've also seen that forums like BRICS and other forums have also seen a lot of positive development and success because of the personal chemistry between the various leaders. We have seen that Prime Minister Narendra Modi shares an excellent personal chemistry with the Russian leader, and his relationship with other world leaders has also contributed to the success of various forums like BRICS. Do you think this is a fair assessment?
Well, personal chemistries work only up to a point. Personal chemistries work when national interests aligned. And as in China's case, we have seen that their national interests are something else, whether it is in South China Sea, whether it is at LAC, or whether it is between Japan and China in the East China Sea. So when there are fundamental differences, then personal chemistry only works up to a point.
The PM went on to say that the questions are being raised on the effectiveness of global institutions. India has been pressing for a very long time that there needs to be a reform, especially in the United Nations Security Council, which is no longer reflective of the present world that we live in. The UNSC has a problem in its working because of the veto power, which is again wielded by 5 permanent states. And we also find China's problem there. Whenever India has taken international terrorists to be designated at the UN, we have found China not to be on the side of India, but opposing it for its own reason. How realistic is it then to expect a change in the UNSC when countries play for their national interests and for their own interests rather than playing for what the PM has rightly said should be the support for multilateralism?
India's foreign policy, as stated by External Affairs S. Jaishankar, is heavily tilted towards realism. And India has realized that it is difficult to persuade the 5 permanent members who, if we follow what present Union Minister Hardeep Puri has written about his stint in the UN Security Council. So we have to work our way through that, and we have to be conscious that there are 188 other countries also that are outside this P5. And as the Prime Minister pointed out, it is not just a UNSC, but World Trade Organization that needs reform, the World Health Organization that needs reform. So when we come to the question of WHO and WTO, then India automatically gets the support of a huge number of developing countries, because it has been batting consistently for least developed countries and for developing countries. So India gets the support of a huge number of that. And you've seen that there's a reflection of that in the huge number of votes that India gets when it contests for UN positions of any kind. So the strategy would be to take this consensus of reforms in UN organs like WHO and WTO, and then to move forward and ultimately touch UNSC. Today's address also, the Prime Minister very clearly said that he wanted the members of all BRICS countries to back India's support for UN reforms. And there was a significant sentence also where the Prime Minister said that India has lost the highest number of peacekeepers who were deployed on UN peacekeeping operations in trouble spots. So India, in a way, has paid its price in blood for multilateralism, and there has to be a recognition somewhere. So there is a consistent effort in that direction, and India's 2-year stint in the UN Security Council as a non-permanent member, I'm sure, will help in the process, because it will tell the world their views, things, and how India should be a very necessary part of the UN Security Council as a permanent membership. And the veto question that you have raised, of course, is a very difficult question. And about veto, again, the veto or the threat of veto has been used by these P5 members to bend other countries to their will. And now there are suggestions that they may include countries with non-veto powers. We don't think such a course would be acceptable to us because India has been fighting this battle to get into the UNSC for well over 2 decades. And it can really afford to spend some more time to get a more fruitful arrangement at the global high table than is being offered by the P5 at present.
We also find that the BRICS summit is taking place at a time when India and China remain locked in a bitter border standoff in eastern Ladakh. Russia, which is currently the chair, has repeatedly said that this dispute should be addressed bilaterally. It has also maintained that multilateral forums like SCO and BRICS can be used by member states to reduce trust deficit between them. How is the functioning of any fora, whether it is SCO or BRICS, affected when there is a trust deficit between nations, as we have seen between India and China? And also, I think more significantly, how can other member states move forward when China's aggressive territorial ambitions are so evident and it is the way it is behaving, whether it is the South China Sea or whether it is Eastern Ladakh?
If we talk about BRICS or if we talk about Shanghai Cooperation Organization, the only country that has a problem with China and this is India. And realism states that when in Shanghai Cooperation, which was formed to sort out border disputes between China and Russia and 3 other Central Asian countries, so there's no border dispute between them. So they would be really looking at it very differently from what we do. As I mentioned, that India is a global power and it has a number of interests. So the border dispute cannot be the holding interest, the only concern that would stop cooperation on all other fronts with other countries that are also there in Shanghai Cooperation. For instance, PM Modi had earlier said at Shanghai Cooperation Organization Summit that it will be used as a gateway for India to Central Asia. So should we then stop all cooperation in SCO because we have a border dispute with China? This is a different thing, and from there, from Central Asia, we can then open up trade routes right up to Russia, into Europe, and maybe have a very different supply chain going, and which is what the Prime Minister is trying to aim for. So border dispute is certainly very important, and you are right that the border dispute between India and China would have certainly played a role in not taking BRICS or SCO to the potentials that we would have anticipated. And maybe that has been acting as a drag. And if we consider the wide areas of cooperation where SCO and BRICS plan to join hands, and the fact that progress is only on a few of them.
We see in the future, India will be the chair of BRICS, and India wants to talk about digital health, traditional medicine. How are these focus areas then going to help India take BRICS forward?
As far as traditional medicine goes, in fact, China is also very strong on traditional medicine, and they also give a lot of emphasis to traditional medicine. And in the last 6 years, we've seen the government in India also giving a lot of emphasis on traditional medicine so that they emerge as low-cost alternatives, and they also help to check lifestyle diseases, in fact. Apart from that, as you said, digital. So digital is a fact that has been dominating the thinking of both the G20 as well as BRICS. And on digital, again, there is a synergy between the thinking of India, China, South Africa in this regard. So this forum becomes very useful because, as you know, in digital, as the PM has repeatedly said, data is the new money, the new oil. And there is a problem on data localization laws with the U.S. Since we see data localization law differently from the U.S., the consensus in BRICS become very useful in putting a unified opinion at the G20 summit. In fact, we saw at the last G20 summit in Osaka, where the BRICS members held a meeting on the sidelines, and there they felt that latitude should be given to developing countries, and it was agreed that data is part of national wealth, and there is need to talk to U.S. and Japan to understand this issue and to synergize it to the Indian requirements. And the fact that there was support coming in from the other BRICS countries, it has become useful to press forward this Indian position.
And in the coming days, we will continue our discussion on India's relationship with BRICS nations and also India's relationship with China and other neighboring countries. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
You are listening to a discussion on 12th BRICS Summit, Global Stability, Shared Security and Innovative Growth. The participants were Sandeep Dixit, strategic analyst, and Simran Sodhi, journalist. This program was produced and presented by the News Services Division of All India Radio. You can listen to it on our mobile app, News on AIR. This program is also available on our website newsonair.com. You may email your opinion about this program at airnsdtalks@gmail.com.